praised for the incredible work that he has done to remind us that today he still does heal. God is as active today as he was back in the beginning of creation. Got to change my frame of thinking now from hearing an incredible testimony to now going into a mediocre sermon. So we're coming to the end of the series on the names of God and learning how to use those names in our prayer life. And I really hope and pray that as a congregation, we have maybe not necessarily used those names, but the characteristic of those names has formed part of our prayer life and has informed our faith that when we pray, we know and understand that God is far greater than the challenges which we do face. So as we come to the end of it, the last name, the name Jesus, which so much of what we have learnt is expressed simply just in that name, Jesus. To start this with, first of all, the sermon, how you go into it. Well, I'm going into the sermon, first of all, with a bit of bad news and then some good news. Don't worry about the bad news too much. But the bad news is that so often we, as the church, are guilty of not understanding who Jesus is. And because we don't take time to understand who he is, our prayer life suffers. And when our prayer life suffers, we miss out on so much that God has for us. And so the bad news is, you're missing out. I'm missing out. Because we need to get our prayer life up more to be able to engage with God in areas that we may not have even thought that he was able to engage with. The good news part of it is God wants you and I to really know who Jesus is, to know him, and to be able to engage with him, to be able to listen to him, to place our faith in situations correctly so that we hear what God as Father, as Son, as Holy Spirit is saying to us in all and every situation and circumstance. I remember some years back attending a conference that was a missions conference, and at this particular conference was somebody who had just come back from a trip to Egypt. The church in Egypt is in some senses a persecuted church in certain parts of Egypt. In other parts of Egypt, it's not as persecuted. But he was talking about that he had been at a mainline denominational church, one that you don't really necessarily expect too much from. And he had met with one of the pastors at the church who was now coming to welcome him to a particular meeting. It was a prayer meeting. And we know from experience, if you want to hold a prayer meeting, it's probably the most unpopular meeting of any church. Well, this particular person was telling me how this pastor who was welcoming people to the prayer meeting on this midweek prayer meeting, was so embarrassed as to the number of people that had pitched up for this prayer meeting. He said to him, "I am so sorry." He said, "We have asked the congregation to please come because we know we have got a visiting person. We are so sorry that so few have turned out. We only managed to get together 3,000 people. We have a lot to learn. We have a lot to learn as to realizing how important our prayer life really is. So what do we learn about prayer? Well, Jesus had a lot to say about prayer. I remember somebody telling me that Jesus had more to say about hell than he had about anything else. So with the use of Google, I went and Googled that. No, Jesus didn't have a lot to say about hell. He had a lot to say about prayer. A lot to say about prayer. Gospel of John, he has this to say about prayer. Jesus answered, "Don't you know me, Philip? Even after I've been among you such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least believe on the evidence of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do works that I have been doing. And they will do even greater things than these, because I'm going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it." So here's an understanding of prayer that Jesus gives. And sometimes this has been interpreted as that when we end our prayer, we say, just before the amen, "in Jesus' name," as though it is to say, it's now been ratified by the Father, it's rubber stamped, it's approved, and it will happen. Well, I've tried that for my Aston Martin. Either that rubber stamp system doesn't work, or it is such a special Aston Martin, it has been put together with tweezers. I guess the former is the more truthful. So we cannot use Jesus' name as a magical formula. That's not what Jesus is speaking about here. But if you go back and you see what he had been speaking about, that Jesus is in the Father, Father is in Jesus, there's this unity that is happening, and that Jesus is saying to Philip, who had asked that question earlier, show us the Father and we'll believe. And Jesus is going, well, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. What he's going on about here is about knowing who Jesus is. Not just knowing this name Jesus, but knowing what is behind this name Jesus. What is the meaning of this name? What is the authority that is behind this name? These are things that we need to keep in our mind. And yes, we do pray in Jesus' name. And we may say, "in Jesus' name," within our prayer. But when we say that, it is understanding the authority in that name and understanding who Jesus is. The writer to the Hebrews, we're going to be reading just chapter 1 and a little bit into chapter 2, but really to fully understand it, you've got to read all 13 chapters. And I thought, well, if we had to do that, we would probably have to have a tea break. So I was quite merciful and only chose the first chapter and a few verses into the second. Let's listen for God's word. "In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom he also made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. So he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. For which of the angels did God ever say, you are my son, today I have become your father? Or again, I will be his father and he will be my son? And again, when God brings his firstborn into the world, he says, let all God's angels worship him. In speaking of the angels, he says, he makes his angels spirits and his servants flames of fire. But about the Son, he says, your throne, O God, will last forever and ever. A scepter of justice will be the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has set you above your companions by anointing you with oil of joy. He also says, in the beginning, Lord, you laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will all wear out like a garment. You will roll them up like a robe, like a garment that will be changed. But you remain the same, and your years will never end. To which of the angels did God ever say, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? Are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who will inherit salvation? We must pay the most careful attention, therefore, to what we have heard, so that we do not drift away. For since the message spoken through angels was binding, and every violation and disobedience received its just punishment, how shall we escape if we ignore so great a salvation? This salvation, which was first announced by the Lord, was confirmed to us by those who heard him. God also testified to it by signs, wonders, and various miracles, and by gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to his will. Jesus' name is a big deal. It really is a big deal. And we need to make a big deal about it. In the first few centuries of the church was not able to meet really too much out in the open because of the persecution that the Christians were undergoing. When the Emperor Constantine became a Christian, one of the things that he did was to officiate over the first council of the church that would happen out in the public domain. It became known as the Council of Nicaea. Nicaea was a city in Constantinople, that's modern-day Turkey. And Constantine called for the 318 bishops to come together and to deliberate as to what does the church believe, and particularly on the divinity of Christ. Because this was the most important matter that the church needed to address, the divinity of Christ. Because everything that we believe, from New Testament through to Old Testament, is based on the divinity of Christ. One of the bishops, a chap by the name of Arius, from which we get known as the Arian problem. We're not talking about Arian problem as in terms of Hitler having the Arian problem. That's not his problem, or the same problem. He had his own problems. But this, what Arius, the bishop of Alexandria, began to profess and to teach was that Jesus wasn't God. He was simply just God's oldest and most beloved creation. Sounds a little bit like the Jehovah's Witnesses. And so he started teaching this, and at this council, this was tested. And they, in a sense, excommunicated Arius. Some years later, unfortunately, Constantine became a little bit too soft and wanted to try and bring Arius back into the church, even though he still taught and believed that Jesus wasn't fully divine. And historians tell us that Arius died from an explosive gastroenteritis. My mind, when I read that, was just like, boom. It's written also that some people said it was divine intervention that he just boomed. Others said, well, it was probably due to poisoning, but I don't think there was anything necessarily related there. But they came up with a statement that they needed to make because of how important this name is. And that if we get it wrong, Jesus himself had taught when he said to Philip, when Philip asked this question, show us the Father, that Jesus had said, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. I and the Father are one. That when Jesus had said to the Pharisees, when he had been speaking about Abraham, or when they had been speaking about Abraham, and he had said, before Abraham was born, I am. In other words, I'm Yahweh. They had to get this right. Now, they already had what was known as the Apostles' Creed. And I've noticed how, when you read church history, throughout the ages, somebody gets a brainwave. They have this incredible thought, and they decide they're going to throw certain things out. And there's been times people have thrown the Apostles' Creed out because, as I said, it's too traditional. And then you normally find within a few decades, the church starts to waver off. And then somebody brings it back in again and it comes back online again. Well, this is one of the reasons why they had to do it. And so they formed formulated what is known as the Nicene Creed. You've probably confessed it in church using the Nicene Creed. Well, it started off with, we're going to pop it up on the screen. It first said these first words, we believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of all things, seen and unseen. And then they stopped there, and then they wrote this about Jesus. And in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, begotten of the Father, the only begotten that is of the essence of the Father, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made both in heaven and on earth, who for us men and for our salvation came down and was incarnate and was made man. He suffered, and on the third day he rose again, ascended into heaven, and from thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. And then they wrote at the end, and in the Holy Spirit. They didn't seem to think that was too important right at that moment. But what they realized, what the important thing was, that if they didn't get this confession about Jesus right, everything that the church was going to do stood on shaky ground. This name, the Son, is the incarnational name of God. Jesus, incarnational name of God. And so the question people ask this when you get into some very deep theology is, well, who was Jesus before he was born? He was God. He was God. That's why we know that those nine names that we have used, that was God himself. And God himself, in the second person of the Trinity, came and dwelt among us. And that, even for the early church, was so important for them to understand that Jesus came and dwelt among us. John himself writes in his letter, he writes, dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. Because many false prophets have gone in and out the world. This is how we recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. But every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is how the spirit of how we know the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming and even now is already in the world. Paul himself recorded in Philippians, which we know was an ancient creed that the church used. And you can probably recite this off by heart, but this is what he wrote. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. The writer of Hebrews tells us that Jesus himself is the Creator. He's a Creator. Because before the incarnation, he was God. And before the whole Old Testament, he was the one who spoke. Let there be light. He spoke it into being. So when I'm praying in the name of Jesus, I'm understanding that this is the one who created, who made all things. Not only is he the one who created, but he's the one who sustains it all. He holds it together. The reason that you and I are not simply there are molecules floating off from ourselves, molecular structures floating away from ourselves and connecting to somebody else. And by the end of the service, there's this different mutation of a human being that's there due to us sharing all our molecules going away. That's the Lord holding it all together. From the molecular structure to the macro structure, he's holding it all together. He's sustaining it. And when we pray to him, when we say in Jesus' name, it's not if you can do this, if you can make this work, if you are merciful enough to get this. We don't have to beg him. He is sustaining all things already. We don't have to ask him to do what he already is doing. It's for us to recognize that he is doing all of these things. He is our Savior, and he has redeemed us. And because he has redeemed us, he owns us. And out of his love and his grace and his mercy, he wants the very best for you and for me. He wants the very best. And so at no point can we ever say, oh, the Lord doesn't want something good for me to happen. Well, I know the Lord doesn't want me to have an Aston Martin. I know exactly the reason for it. I know the reason. I just don't want to confess it. I'm in denial. But I know the reason why. He knows. He saw me before I was born. He saw me in my younger years. He knows where my inclinations are. So he's not giving me that. But nowhere in Scripture does it say that I can't stop praying for it. He is my justifier. He's the one who imputes me with his righteousness. He's the one who is the intercessor, who before the throne of the Father is saying, will you help that person? Will you make all the promises that are in Scripture, yes and amen, in that person's life? He's doing all this to ensure that this will happen in our lives. He is our ruler, King of kings and Lord of lords. He has authority over all things. There is nothing that has evaded him. There is nothing where we need to go to him and say to him, Jesus, did you see the papers today? He knew it before it was even written. And he rules over it. And when he speaks, whatever he speaks to will obey. He doesn't speak with a suggestion. How like we as parents, when we say, will you do the following? It's usually the opening bid for negotiation. with Jesus, when he speaks, it will obey. It will. He is eternal. And we don't understand that because we understand time. As I've been looking through my sermon as my clock going, yeah, time's going very, very fast. And I'm going, okay. But I'm locked into time. We are locked into time. He's not. And he can be at your birth and at your death at the exact same moment. So we need not fear. As we never feared our birth, we need not fear our death. And we need not fear anything in between. Because he's there. Sustaining us, holding us, and keeping us there. But as we apply this, obviously there is implications regarding this. The writer of Hebrews says, he warns us, don't drift away. It's easy to drift away. Drifting away doesn't look like, well, so-and-so isn't coming to church any longer. Arius drifted away. And he was bishop of Alexandria. He had drifted away from the faith, but he was still very involved within the life and the work of the church. Although he met a horrible end. Don't drift away. Don't ever drift away. Don't drift away from knowing the power in the name of Jesus. Don't ever drift away. Worship team, start coming up. Don't ever drift away. But if we are struggling, if we're struggling to grasp this, as Jesus said to Philip, if you're struggling to grasp this, that I'm in the Father, Father is in me, if you're struggling to grasp this, just look at the works. Look at what the Father is doing through me. Look at what the Son is doing. And as he said, you will go and do greater works. It doesn't mean that we'll do works that are better than Jesus. It just that was a geographical thing. He was in Galilee. And the greater works are is that that same work will be done in Mandra. If the church wakes up and understands the power and the authority of Jesus. If the church wakes up, not if Mandra wakes up. Mandra can't wake up. It doesn't have Jesus. So it can't wake up. But the church who is awake and who has the name of Jesus, praise that. Then what we see, believe on at least the miracles because you know where they've come from. For God himself will testify through his own works that what he is able to do to change the hearts, the hardest people. You've heard a testimony this morning. Is it too hard for God to heal? No. Is it too hard for God to change a city? Sometimes we have reluctant prophets. Sometimes we are more like Jonah. We grumble when we have on our lips the name of Jesus.
Jesus.
If anybody requires a time of ministry, just a time of prayer, after I've pronounced the benediction, you're welcome to come take a seat here in the front. One of the elders, ministry team, or myself will come and pray with you in Jesus' name. Let us receive God's blessing. Go now in peace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with each one of us now and forevermore. Amen.
Jesus, your name.